हेलो, वेलकम टू दिस 37th ऑनलाइन लेक्चर सेशन ऑफ द कोर्स इंजीनियरिंग थर्मोडायनेमिक्स। यस्टरडे वी हैड डिस्कशन ऑन द रेफ्रिजरेशन साइकिल्स एंड इन पर्टिकुलर वी हैव टॉक्ड अबाउट वेपर कंप्रेशन रेफ्रिजरेशन सिस्टम। ओके, सो व्हाइल वी हैव डन द मॉडिफिकेशन फ्रॉम रिवर्स कार्नोट साइकिल टू वेपर कंप्रेशन साइकिल, देन वी हैव कन्वर्टेड और वी हैव एक्चुअली यूज्ड थ्रोटलिंग एक्सपेंशन डिवाइस इन प्लेस ऑफ our turbine. Okay, and while we are using that refrigerator, we are considering that our working medium in the throttling device, while its pressure is decreasing, with decrease in pressure its temperature is also decreasing. Okay, so that assumption we have considered. But initially, if you recall to my earlier lectures, once I told that it is not always true that in case of expansion device, throttling device, we will be having decrease in temperature while the pressure of the working medium is actually decreasing. Okay, so that is not always true. Okay, so what will be happening to the temperature while we are passing a substance through expansion device? That is something which is explained by one very very important parameter which is called as Joule-Thomson coefficient. Okay, so we will first see the applicability of Joule-Thomson coefficient in defining whether temperature will decrease upon expansion or increase or remain constant. Okay, and after that we will start our discussion on one more new thermodynamic property which is called as exergy. So what is exergy? I will discuss after having a discussion on the Joule-Thomson coefficient. Okay, so this is a typical representation of a throttling device. So here you can see this is nothing but a pipe, and say in this pipe flow is taking place from left to right, and we are having some obstruction over here. So obviously what will be happening, this obstruction will actually try to decrease the pressure on the downstream of the obstruction. So you can see in the upstream of the obstruction we are having pressure of 800 kilopascal and temperature of 20 degrees Celsius. Okay, and in the downstream of the obstruction we are saying that we are having pressure of 200 kilopascal. So it means while substance has passed through this expansion device, its pressure has decreased. Okay, and then we are writing that our temperature T2, it can be either greater than 20, it can be less than 20, or it can be equal to 20 degrees Celsius. So what will be happening to the value of temperature? That is something can be decided by using some important parameter which is referred to as Joule-Thomson coefficient. So generally the symbol for Joule-Thomson coefficient is mu, and we use subscript JT to specify Joule-Thomson. Okay, so if the value of this Joule-Thomson coefficient is greater than zero, okay, so if value of Joule-Thomson coefficient is greater than zero, then in that case our in that particular situation our T2, whatever I have taken over here, that T2 will be actually less in comparison to T1. Okay, so if Joule-Thomson coefficient is positive, then we will be having decrease of temperature. If Joule-Thomson coefficient is equal to zero, then we will be having T2 equal to T1. We will not be having any change of temperature. And if Joule-Thomson coefficient is less than zero, in that case we will be finding that T2 will be greater than T1. So it means if Joule-Thomson coefficient is negative, then upon the expansion we will be having actually heating of the substance. Okay, so these are the different typical conditions which can occur. Now why for any particular value of Joule-Thomson coefficient this cooling, heating and is happening, or why temperature is remaining constant, then let us try to understand. Okay, so what I have done over here, I have considered some pipe, and in this pipe I have taken some porous plug. Okay, so what I am having over here in this pipe, I am having some porous plug. So the meaning of porous plug is we are having some solid material, and in that solid material we are having some pores. Okay, and these pores will allow flow to pass through it. So these pores will allow whatever the substance we are passing, fluid we are passing, these pores will allow that fluid to pass through it. But depending upon the thickness of the pore, depending upon the thickness of the pore, we will be having decrease in pressure in the downstream side. Okay. So what we have done, we have considered some medium. So now in this pipe, we are having porous plug and we are considering that flow is happening from right to left. Okay. So the direction of flow over here is from right to left. So what we are saying that at the inlet side, at the inlet of the porous plug, we have fixed our thermodynamic state of the substance. Okay. So at the inlet, we have fixed our thermodynamic state of the substance, and that is nothing but P1 pressure, T1 temperature. Okay. And after that, flow is happening through this porous plug. So once the flow will be happening in the porous plug, in the downstream, we will be having pressure P2 and temperature T2. Okay. And now, depending upon the thickness of this porous plug. So for example, if say in the first situation, I have thickness P1. So depending upon the thickness of the porous plug, we will be having different output states. Okay. So first, what I am saying that I have considered P1, T1 as my fixed inlet state. So let me define over here inlet state on this temperature and pressure diagram. So on this temperature and pressure diagram, I am defining inlet state as my state number 1. Okay. And now let us consider that initially while I was having T1 as the thickness of the porous plug, corresponding to that my final state, so this is my say final state number 2, when I was having thickness of porous plug as nothing but T1. Okay, so this was my final state when I was having thickness of porous plug as T1. Now if I increase the thickness of porous plug from T1 to T2. So now if I take my thickness of porous plug is T2, which is greater than T1. In this case, what will be happening? Now if my porous plug is more thicker, what will be happening? We will be having actually less pressure in comparison to the pressure which we were having earlier corresponding to T1 thickness. Okay. So if I take T2 as my thickness of the porous plug, my final state 2 will be having less pressure. So when T1 was thickness, corresponding to that pressure was somewhere over here. So now I'll be having more less value of the pressure. So say this is my state corresponding to thickness of the porous plug as nothing but T2. Similarly, I will be taking one more state T3, which is one more thickness of porous plug, which will be greater than even T2. So now I will be having further decrease of pressure. So here say this is my state corresponding to further decrease in pressure. So what we are doing, we are having fixed inlet state, but we are varying the thickness of the porous plug over here. So upon varying the thickness of the porous plug, what we are finding that we are having reduced value of the pressure if we are increasing the thickness. And obviously when we are having a different extent of expansion in the porous plug, then our temperature at the outlet will also be changing. So we are using over here some thermometer to measure the temperature at the outlet. Okay. So now corresponding to different thickness of the porous plug, we are finding that our final states are something like this. Okay. Now if we join the line passing through all these final points, because one thing you can see, this was inlet state and this is outlet state. So inlet state is always fixed. Then this is inlet state, this is outlet state. So that is corresponding to some new thickness of porous plug T2. Similarly, inlet state is remaining same, and then corresponding to some T3 thickness, we are having some another outlet state. Okay, so exit states are different for different thickness of the porous plug. Okay, now one thing you can see, and this different thickness of the porous plug is nothing but represents the extent up to which we are expanding our substance. Okay, so that is what we are calling as so basically thickness of the porous plug is defining the extent of expansion. Okay, so now we know what we do if we join the locus of all these exit states. If we join the locus of all these exit states, we will be getting some line. Okay. and this particular line we will be calling as nothing but constant enthalpy line. So if H is my enthalpy, then I will be calling this line as nothing but my constant enthalpy line on the TP diagram. So why I am calling it as constant enthalpy line? Because this process we are doing as nothing but throttling process, okay? And we know that throttling process is a constant enthalpy process. Throttling process is isenthalpic process. So that's why what I am saying that H over here is actually enthalpy is constant for this particular line, okay? Now, one important thing you can see, if I calculate the slope of this temperature pressure plot, if I calculate the slope of temperature pressure plot del T by del P, okay, if I calculate this slope del T by del P at constant enthalpy, because we are obtaining constant enthalpy line, so whatever the slope I have to calculate for temperature and pressure, that I will be calculating along the constant enthalpy line, okay. So if I calculate this slope, I will be finding in this particular region, you can see, I will be finding del T by del P at constant enthalpy as nothing but equal to T2 minus T1 divided by P2 minus P1. Okay. So in this particular region, you can see what is the value of slope. So if you see T2 over here is more in comparison to T1, so this numerator will be positive, and in the denominator if you see P2 is less in comparison to P1, so we are having negative slope over here. So it means on the right hand side of this point, so if I say this as point, on the right hand side of this point I have slope del T by del P of constant enthalpy line as nothing but negative, okay. And if you go to left, in the left we will be finding value of slope of del T by del P at constant enthalpy as nothing but positive. And we will be finding some point over here at which our value of slope is equal to 0. Okay. So the point at which value of slope is 0, that we call as nothing but our inversion point. Okay. So this is one very, very important information. The point at which our value of slope is 0, that point we call as inversion point, and on the right of inversion point we are having negative slope of del T by del P for a constant enthalpy line, and on the left hand side we are having positive slope for the same, okay. So now what will be happening, you can see this del T by del P is, so what we can see that where we are having negative slope, in that section we are having heating of the substance upon decrease of pressure. So this is one important information you can see. While we are having negative slope over here on the right hand side, there when we are decreasing the pressure, we are having nothing but our heating of. So in the right hand side, when we are having negative slope, there we are having heating of our working substance, okay. And if I go to left side, in the left side I have positive slope, so here I will be having nothing but cooling of the working medium if we are passing it through the expansion device, okay. And at this particular inversion point, if we see at this inversion point, if we are having some expansion process, so there we will not be having any change in temperature of the working substance, okay. So this is one very, very important information. So it means in case of a refrigeration, if we have to do cooling of the refrigerant medium into our expansion device, we have to operate that refrigerant on the left side of the inversion point, okay. Now this slope whatever I have defined over here, del T by del P at constant enthalpy, this is particularly called as Joule-Thomson coefficient, okay. So Joule-Thomson coefficient is nothing but del T divided by del P for constant enthalpy line. So now whatever I have told you over here, that we can actually relate to the slope del T by del P on this particular temperature pressure plot for which we have shown a constant enthalpy line, okay. So one important point we are getting that if we are operating on the left, on the right side of the inversion point, for example, if I start from here and if I stop at any point on the right of the inversion point, I will be always having heating. Okay. And if I move towards the, I am starting from here only, but I am expanding to an extent that I am shifting on the left of the inversion point. So when I will be moving to the left of the inversion point, there I will be actually able to experience some cooling. Okay. Now, if we repeat this process, so what we have done, you can see previously that we have fixed some inlet state and then we have actually varied the varies the extent of expansion. Okay. So now if I fix some inlet state, say P1, T1, then if I fix some another inlet state, say P2, T2, and another inlet state as say P3, T3, and then if I try to find out the exit states for all these different fixed inlet states, we will be finding multiple constant enthalpy lines. So everywhere over here we are having enthalpy as constant because these lines are plotted by expansion through a throttling process. Okay, so in throttling process enthalpy remains constant. Okay, so we will be finding multiple lines over here. So in these multiple lines you can see we are having some inversion point on each and every line. So if we join locus of all the inversion points, so the line formed by locus of all the inversion points is actually referred to as nothing but inversion line. Okay, and we have already seen that on the right hand side of the inversion line we will be having Joule Thomson coefficient as negative, so that's why in this region we will be having nothing but heating of the working medium upon expansion. And on the left hand side, Joule Thomson coefficient will be greater than zero. So over here we will be having cooling of the working substance. Here we will be having cooling of the working substance upon actually expanding. Okay. So this is the region where we operate our refrigerants. While we do throttling in case of refrigerant, we have to operate in this region, cooling region. Okay. Now you can see when our value of pressure is becoming zero, so corresponding to zero value of pressure, our inversion line is actually crossing the boundary, crossing our this temperature axis. Okay. So the point at which it is touching our temperature axis, that we call as nothing but maximum inversion temperature. Okay. So this we call as nothing but our maximum inversion temperature. And once we have crossed the boundary of maximum inversion temperature, then we will always be having heating irrespective of the extent of expansion whatever we are doing. Okay, so this is a very very important curve while we actually talk about cooling of gaseous mediums. Okay, now let me just little bit give you one more detail. So if I have to write down enthalpy equation, if I have to write down generalized enthalpy equation, it will be something like this. dH will be equal to Cp times dT. Okay, dH will be equal to Cp times dT plus V minus T del V divided by del T at constant pressure into dP. Okay, so if you recall to our earlier lectures, we have defined that dH is equal to TdS minus VdP. Okay, so we have taken some property relation. So if we go further deeper into the thermodynamic property relations, so that is not actually part of our syllabus, but if we go further deeper into thermodynamic property relations, we will be able to determine some generalized enthalpy equation which will be applicable for any kind of substance, and that generalized enthalpy equation will be nothing but dH equal to Cp into dT plus volume minus T del V by del T at constant pressure into dP. So this, at this moment I am writing this equation directly because this is part of the thermodynamic property relations and that is actually beyond the scope of our course. Okay, so at the moment you simply remember it that this is some generalized enthalpy equation which can be derived from the thermodynamic property relations. Okay. Now, in this equation, if we apply this equation for any of the expansion process, so we know that for expansion process, H will be equal to constant. So, our value of dH will be 0. Okay. For expansion process, dH will be equal to 0. Now, from here, you can see we will be finding that dT divided by dP at constant enthalpy. So, I should write it as del because it is having dependence on multiple variables. So, I can see over here from this particular equation, I can write if I take H as constant and if I say dH is equal to 0, I can write del T by del P at constant enthalpy as nothing but equal to minus 1 divided by Cp. So, this will be coming to one side. So, minus 1 by Cp times V minus P into del V divided by del T at constant pressure. Okay. So, this we will be getting and we know del T by del P is at constant enthalpy is nothing but our Joule-Thomson coefficient. Okay. So, it means we have got the expression for Joule-Thomson coefficient and by using this equation, by knowing that different properties for any substance, we can actually determine the value of Joule-Thomson coefficient for that particular substance. Okay. So, if now we talk about air, generally we consider that air is nothing but our ideal gas. Okay. So, under the assumptions of ideal gas, I can write that PV equal to RT. Okay. So, this I can write PV is equal to RT. Now, if I have to calculate this term del V by del T at constant pressure, so I can write V as nothing but equal to RT divided by P. Okay. Now, if I have to calculate del V divided by del T at constant pressure, that will be coming R by P will be constant and del T by del T will be 1. Okay. So, that will be coming as nothing but equal to R by P. Now, if I substitute this in the above expression, I will be finding that mu times JT is nothing but equal to mu times JT is nothing but equal to minus 1 by Cp times V minus T into del V by del T. Del V by del T is nothing but R by P. Okay. So, now you can see over here mu JT for ideal gas is becoming equal to mu JT for ideal gas is becoming equal to R into T by P. R into T by P is nothing but once again V. So, this entire quantity is once again V. So, it is becoming V minus V. It means for ideal gas, our Joule-Thomson coefficient is nothing but equal to 0. Okay. So, it means if I take some ideal gas and if I expand that ideal gas, say this is my inlet point, point number 1. And if I expand this ideal gas through throttling device, I will be finding that I will be having decrease of pressure from P1 to P2, but temperature will be remaining constant because for ideal gas, value of Joule-Thomson coefficient is nothing but equal to 0. Okay. So, now we have seen three different things that if we are operating in the positive value of the Joule-Thomson, that is on the left of the inversion line, then we will be having cooling of our substance. And if we are operating on the right side of the Joule-Thomson, right side of the inversion line, then we will be having heating of the substance. And when we are actually having value of Joule-Thomson coefficient equal to 0, at that point, we will be finding that upon the expansion in a throttling device, we will be having constant value of the temperature. Okay. So, this is very, very important topic, particularly related to selection of the refrigerant. So, while selecting the refrigerant for our refrigeration and air conditioning units, we have to consider that our operating range, whatever we are having for our refrigerating unit, in that our working medium should operate on the left of the inversion line. Okay. Now, we are having another very important topic and this is actually the last topic of our syllabus. Okay. So, till this moment, we all are familiar with the concept of energy and we are also knowing many other thermodynamic properties. For example, internal energy, we are knowing enthalpy, we are knowing kinetic energy, potential energy, temperature, pressure, volume, etc. Okay. So, likewise, we are having one more property over here, and this particular property we call as exergy. And there are many synonyms for the same, so it is also called as availability and it is also called as available energy. Okay, so the term available energy was first floated by School of Engineering of MIT in 1940, and later on this term was popularly being called as exergy, and the term exergy is actually floated somewhere in 1915 in Europe. Okay, now exergy is one very very important property which actually helps us or enable us in determining that what is the available potential associated with some source of energy. Okay, so when we are exploring certain source of energy, we may find that the amount of energy is almost same or almost similar with different sources available, but the potential for utilizing that energy or converting that energy into useful amount of work may be different with different sources. Okay, so exergy is the property which enables us to determine the potential available for work in with some source of energy. Okay, so now let us understand this concept with the help of one example. So what I have considered over here, I have shown you some tank. Okay, so this is let me consider it is nothing but a fuel tank. Okay, and this fuel tank is having some burner also over here. So this part over here is say some burner we are having. Okay, and now this fuel tank and burner, these are actually enclosed in some boundary, and let us consider whatever this boundary we are having, that is nothing but our insulated boundary. So we are considering that our boundary is actually insulated. So if our boundary is insulated, it means it is nothing but our isolated system. So this is the example of isolated system, because we are having insulated boundary, so we will not be having any energy interaction over here. Okay, and mass interaction already we are not considering. And now let us consider that we are having significant amount of air over here inside this one. Okay, so what we are having, we are having some fuel tank, and that fuel tank is coupled to a burner, and then we are having some boundary, and inside that boundary is actually enclosing our fuel tank, and then within that boundary we are having significant amount of air. So we are having amount of air which is significantly large in comparison to the amount of fuel available. Okay, so now if you see, this is our first condition, say let me define as thermodynamic state number one. Then I have some another thermodynamic state two, and in this second thermodynamic state two, what we have done, we are having some flame over here. So it means we are actually doing the combustion of the fuel. Okay, so by using this burner, we are actually doing the combustion of the fuel, and we have found over here that now some amount of fuel has already consumed. So we are having now say some 50 to 60% of the fuel available over here. Okay, and remaining amount of fuel has actually burnt. So if remaining amount of fuel has burnt, what will be happening? Say if I define my initial temperature as T1, so that is the temperature of the air. So now I will be finding when certain amount of fuel has burnt, then I will be finding my temperature of air as T2. And if I say that I am having a significantly large amount of air, okay, so infinite amount of air, so in that case what will be happening, T2 will be larger than T1, but it the difference between T2 and T1 will be nothing but very very small. So T2 will be T1 plus dT only. Okay, so we will be having very slight increase in temperature. And then we are considering the third situation where our fuel tank is actually entirely empty. So in the third situation, what we are having, our fuel tank is entirely empty, and over here say we are having some temperature T3, and that temperature T3 will once again will be nothing but T2 plus dT. So where this dT refers to very small rise in temperature, slight rise in temperature. Why we are calling slight rise in temperature? Because we are having significant amount of air. So if we are having significant amount of air, obviously the rise of temperature will be very, very small. Okay. And why temperature is rising? Because this boundary is insulated. So if the boundary is insulated, so whatever the amount of energy will be released by the fuel, that energy will be employed in terms of raising the temperature of the air. Okay. Now, let us first try to see from the energy conservation point of view. So if you look from the energy conservation point of view, so initially we were having certain amount of air, and that air was at temperature T1. Okay. So if air was at temperature T1, obviously it was carrying certain amount of internal energy. So let me consider that the internal energy associated with this air was initially say U1. So U1 was the amount of internal energy which was associated with this air. Okay. And let me now consider that we are having this fuel over here. So with this fuel, whatever the energy was there, that was also as internal energy of the fuel only, but mainly that internal energy was stored in the form of chemical energy of the fuel. Okay. So what we were having initially chemical plus internal energy of air, whereas the magnitude of chemical energy was large. So this was the dominant energy, and then we were having small amount of internal energy. So how I can explain? Let me say that I was having say 100 kilojoules of chemical energy stored in the fuel. So I can write over here as 100 kilojoule of energy, plus I was having say 10 kilojoule as internal energy in the air. So that 10 kilojoule I can write over here. So my total was nothing but 100 plus 10. Now, if I take second situation, in the second situation, what we have done, now we are having amount of fuel left is actually something around 60% to that of the original fuel tank volume. So now we will be having chemical energy stored as nothing but 60 kilojoules. Okay. And we were having 10 kilojoule as the internal energy of the air. But now what has happened, while this 40% of the fuel has burnt, that has released some energy. Okay. And obviously, whatever the amount of energy has been released, that energy has been stored in the form of internal energy of the air. So it means at this point, if we see, we are having chemical energy as only 60 kilojoules. And then if we talk about internal energy, now 10 originally we were having, and 40 kilojoule of energy has been added to this air upon the combustion of the fuel, because chemical energy of the fuel has converted into internal energy. Okay. So now here I will be having 60 plus internal energy has become nothing but 50. Okay. So here also, if you see, the total is 110. Here also total amount of energy is 110. Now, if I go to third situation, in third situation, I have this tank as entirely empty. So it means at this point, I have zero kilojoule as the chemical energy stored in the fuel. And here we were having 10 plus, while entire amount of fuel will be burning, it will be converting into equivalent amount of internal energy. So plus 0 plus 100, I have to write over here. Okay. So now here I can see that my chemical energy plus internal energy of the air, chemical is 0 and internal energy of air is actually 110, and that is making our total as 110. So now if you see, in each of this situation, we are having same amount of energy. For the first also, we have same 110 kilojoule, for second also 110, and for the third also 110. But one important point I have told you, that in first case, majority of the energy is stored in the form of its chemical energy. In second case, it is partial chemical, partial internal energy. And in the third case, entire amount of energy is stored in the form of internal energy only. Okay. And one more thing I have told, that I have taken significantly large amount of air. Okay, so I have taken significantly large amount of air. So if I have significant amount of air, the change in temperature of the air will be very small in comparison to its initial temperature. So say if initial temperature was T1, I will be having some intermediate temperature as T1 plus dT, where dT is actually very, very small. And finally, also I will be having T3 as T2 plus dT. Once again, this dT is actually very, very small rise in temperature. Okay. So now in third situation, if you see, whatever the total amount of energy we are having, that is all in the form of internal energy. And if we have to employ this internal energy to do any work, what we have to do? Basically, we have to transfer this internal energy from this substance in the form of heat energy only. Okay, so we will be say connecting this our entire system to some heat engine, and that heat engine will be then getting this internal energy in the form of heat energy, and then that will be converting our heat into work. Okay, so ultimately this internal energy is actually providing the heat energy for running our heat engine. Okay, so that is providing energy for running our heat engine, and that heat engine is actually finally converting or giving us certain amount of work. So we can say that our internal energy is getting converted into work. That is the ultimate aim. Okay. So now we know that when this internal energy will be transferring in the form of heat, we cannot convert complete amount of heat energy into equivalent amount of work. Okay. So it means whatever the internal energy we are having over here, this energy will be having the least potential to convert it into equivalent amount of work. Okay, so this will be having least potential, and where initially we are having say all the energy stored in the form of chemical energy of the fuel, this chemical energy of the fuel directly I can employ for heating our steam in case of thermal power plant, and then that heat can be employed, or that high pressure, high temperature steam can be employed to produce some power. I can use this fuel in our automobiles to power our vehicles. Okay, so it means while energy we are having in the first state, that energy is having highest potential to do useful work. Okay, so this energy is having highest potential to do useful work, and whatever the third state we are having, here we are having least potential to do work. So one important point you can see over here, and another distinction I have to tell you, that here my temperature is actually slightly increased. So when I will be transferring over here heat between the slight temperature, with slight temperature rise to some heat engine, then rate of heat transfer will also be very, very large. Okay, so it means that we may have different sources of energy available, and we may have overall content of the energy as same. So you can see in these three different situations, the overall content of the energy is same, but energy as a sole parameter is not sufficient enough to define that what is the potential of available work we are having with that source of energy. Okay, so for that we require some additional parameter. For example, in this case we can just comment from our knowledge of thermodynamics that highest potential is having 100% fuel, and the lowest potential will be having when we are having energy stored in the form of only internal energy. For example, you can see in our ambient atmosphere we are having large amount of air, and that air is having atmospheric pressure and temperature say close to 30 degrees Celsius. So obviously our atmosphere is actually carrying significant amount of energy. Okay, but that energy is stored in the form of internal energy of the atmosphere, and it is almost at the surrounding condition only. So that energy is actually not having much potential to do work. So it is not having even any potential to obtain some useful amount of work. Okay, so it is not the amount of energy which is important, it is the quality of the energy which is an important parameter for defining the potential of work that can be extracted from that source of energy. Okay, so exergy is a parameter which defines or which enables us to determine the maximum potential of available energy or maximum potential of work that is available with some source of energy. So that's why while we will be talking about thermodynamically, we will be talking about any source of the energy along with determining the magnitude of energy. We will also try to quantify. We will also try to quantify the value of exergy associated with that substance. Okay. So now let me tell you some of the important concepts before going more deeper into the concept of exergy. So we are having two important concepts. Dead state and surroundings. Okay, so dead state, I have already also told you that if our system is reaching to the conditions of surroundings. Okay, so if our system, if properties of the system is equivalent to that of the properties of the surrounding, then we say that our system has actually reached in complete thermodynamic equilibrium with its surrounding and our system is in the dead state. Because any deviation from the surrounding, for example, if our pressure is more in comparison to surrounding pressure, we will be having expansion of the, we can do expansion of the piston. Okay. And if we are having our temperature more than the surrounding temperature, then we can employ some heat engine in between our system and surrounding and we can extract certain work and some process will be happening. Okay. So it means that if our system is having thermodynamic parameters other than the thermodynamic parameters of the surrounding, we cannot call our system in thermodynamic equilibrium. Okay. And if our system is having, if our system is having thermodynamic states equivalent to that of the thermodynamic state of the surrounding, then that system will not be undergoing any process and we can call it is in thermodynamic equilibrium with its surroundings. Okay. So one typical representation I have shown you over here. So you can see our surrounding condition is 25 degrees Celsius temperature and pressure as 101 kilopascals. And we are having some system, some tank, and we are having some valve attached to this tank. And this tank is containing air at 25 degrees Celsius, 101 kilopascals, and it is having kinetic energy zero and potential energy zero. So now at this point, we can say that our system is in actually thermodynamic equilibrium and it has reached nothing but our dead state. Okay. And one important point I would also like to highlight, when we represent the state of the system, particularly corresponding to dead state, we use zero as the subscript. So for example, if I have to call the pressure of this system, so I'll be calling as P0. Similarly, I'll be calling temperature as T0. So property of the system corresponding to dead state is actually denoted by subscript 0. Okay. Then we are having one more concept of surroundings over here. So we know anything which is outside our system is actually called as surrounding. Okay. But while we will be studying the concept of exergy, we will be dividing our surroundings into immediate surrounding and environment. Okay. So in general, our environment and immediate surrounding both constitutes our overall surrounding, but any portion of the surrounding which is actually in close vicinity of the system and is affected by the process which is happening in the system, that is called as immediate surrounding. And anything outside immediate surrounding which is not affected by the process which is happening inside the system, that is called as environment. For example, if I have hot potato, so outside the hot potato, if it is placed in a room, so the room temperature will be mainly 25 degrees Celsius. And say if the temperature of the potato surface is 70 degrees Celsius, so we will be finding that along the boundary of this potato, we will be having some air in its immediate vicinity that will be having temperature in between the room temperature and the temperature of potato. So we will be having temperature variation in between 25 to 70. So this particular regime is actually referred to as the immediate surrounding. And anything which is not affected by the process which is happening inside the which is happening inside our system, which is happening inside system, that we call as nothing but our environment. Okay, and so now let me stop at this point, and we will have our further discussion of exergy in our next lecture. Okay,
sir, how you are